First, I want to thank our congressmen and women, a woman, for being here, Garret Graves and Julia Letlow. They've been on the phone with us the whole time, along with Steve Scalise, making sure we were getting everything we needed and finding out what we needed. So they these two were able to come today. We appreciate it. Look, I'm going to tell you, they're fighting for Tangipahoa Parish. They're fighting for Louisiana. And we're fighting with them to make sure that our citizens get taken care of as quickly as possible with all the resources that we have available to us. And not going to stand for the idea that it's too slow or not enough, that it's going to happen. And I know that they made the commitments to do that, and I know that they're going to. With that being said, I'll turn it over to Congresswoman Letlow. She covers about half of our parish, and we appreciate her time being here. And we know that she's going to take care of us, and we appreciate it. So, Julia?
Thank you so much for having us today. I just thought it was really important for the people from this parish to see that we are a united Louisiana delegation, and it's no longer about being a part of the Democratic or Republican Party. We are united to make sure that our people receive the recovery funds that they need to help rebuild this region. And I'm so thankful to have Congressman Garret Graves here with me today. This is not his first rodeo. He is an expert in disaster recovery, and it's so important that the people from this region, they're able to voice their concerns to Congressman Graves and to us as a delegation. So I'd like to turn it over to Congressman Graves for his remarks. Thank you.
First, I want to thank Congresswoman Letlow and President Miller for inviting us here today, and also Congressman Scalise, who's been urging us to come visit as well. Look, every disaster is different. You can't just come in and apply the same response or the same package to every single disaster, whether it's a 2016 flood or it's Hurricane Katrina. And so one of the reasons that we're here is to hear directly from the parish, from the parish president, from council members, from the emergency preparedness officials, to understand exactly what Tangipahoa needs in terms of their immediate needs for emergency response, for hurricane response activities. But the other thing we're doing is hearing from them about what long-term recovery looks like in Tangipahoa Parish. How should we do this? Let me say it again. Every disaster is not the same. We shouldn't do the same recovery package for every disaster. And we need to learn from the mistakes of the past. We had the Louisiana Restore Program from the 2016 flood. Here we are almost 5 years after that disaster, and less than half of the money has actually been given to flood victims. That's unacceptable. And so we want to make sure that as we move forward and work with the White House and work with Republicans and Democrats, that we are actually tailoring a package that's responsive to the needs of the folks in South Louisiana, but most importantly, it's responsive to the urgency that we have. And so it's been great hearing, again, directly from the parish president, from the emergency response officials, from the council members, about what the priorities here are here, what the needs are here, and we're gonna make sure that we take that back to Washington and work with the White House and work with leaders in Congress to have the fingerprints of Tangipahoa Parish on that recovery package.
Well, the immediate need here seems to be more FEMA representation here, more personnel on the ground to talk to our citizens, to make sure that they're getting all the opportunities to apply and then receive. We need clear information from FEMA about what is available to us and what are we getting. Our citizens are getting mixed messages from the website and from the application process. So we just want to know what they need, what they're going to get, so they know how to prepare and we know how to assist them. Our electricity is getting worked on, it's coming back. Our gas fuel is showing up. It's a little easier to get. So, some of the life support systems for us are becoming more normal now. Our sewer and water's been up the whole time, pretty much 24 hours after the storm. We were in good shape there. But there's still, a lot of just need. Thank goodness we have literally over several thousand volunteer service organizations here that are helping our citizens clear their property, get the debris up to the road. So the big thing for us is the support, the FEMA support, to know exactly what we're getting and then to get it to us. Longer term will be how does that system work faster so the dollars get to us faster for recovery, so that the homes that need to be raised, those dollars come here and let's get them raised or bought, purchased, so that they can be taken out. Help us harden and make sure that all the backup systems are in place for our sewer and water districts, so that we never have a problem with sewer and water. And then after that, probably some shelter issues for us to be able to handle during the immediate time right after the storm. Those are some biggies. And then, of course, our private sector, making sure that they are hardened with Entergy having better systems, propane, gas, internet, those things that they can take this beating a little bit better.
Sure. Yeah, I'll give you an example. The president noted one of the challenges they have is some of the debris in the waterways and adjacent to the waterways. And just understanding the bureaucracy, is this a parish responsibility? Is it FEMA? Is it the Corps of Engineers? Is it Coast Guard? Is it the Natural Resources Conservation Service? So just in some cases, it's getting the right answers and making sure that we have dollars in the right accounts to address the specific problems here. If you have a tornado in Kansas, you probably aren't going to have a lot of debris in your waterways. If you have anything happen in Louisiana, that's going to be a challenge that we have here. One of the other things is that sort of the unique terrain or geography here, making sure that we're really thoughtful about as we rebuild and these people take these flood insurance checks and invest them back in their home and in their business, how can we ensure them that this is going to be a safe, secure place? So how do we complement our recovery with investments in flood protection, investments in resiliency, and making sure that we're not asking people to invest back in a place that's unsafe? That's not something that I would ever suggest or want to have any involvement in when you're talking about the lives of our community, these families and businesses across South Louisiana. Look, let's be clear. We're talking apples and oranges right now. So there's a recovery bill that even President Biden has requested funds of the Congress just yesterday. Recovery from Hurricane Ida. You remember back in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, Congress provided $15 billion to develop a better flood protection or levee system for the five parishes around New Orleans. So let's focus on tailoring a recovery package for Hurricane Ida. Do we need infrastructure investments long-term outside the realm of Hurricane Ida? Without question. My two concerns with the legislation that's on the table right now, number one, under the Biden's budget, for the Corps of Engineers, they've said they will prohibit any funds to be invested in flood protection, coastal restoration, dredging, drainage for projects that benefit oil and gas. Oil and gas is integrated into the fabric of our community in South Louisiana. Does that mean we're going to be excluded from Corps of Engineer project investments in our community? Secondly, under the transportation grant programs, which again, do we need transportation infrastructure dollars in South Louisiana? Without question. But under their criteria, they said they're going to prioritize environmental justice, racial equity, and climate change. There's not criteria or ways to quantify that in a way that makes sense. I want dollars going where you get the best return on investment, period. And so I'm concerned about the lack of clarity or transparency on how they're going to allocate dollars. And if anybody thinks I'm crying wolf, whenever they got their first $1 billion allocation of funds, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, Arkansas were all left out. We got goose egged, and I'm concerned about giving them quadruple dollars whenever they're excluding us from important investments like that. Well, I think one of the lessons we learned from Hurricane Katrina is that it's not fair, it's not just, and it's simply a huge mistake for us to come in and say, oh, look, we're going to build the levee here just to flood the adjacent area. Extensive computer modeling was done for the West Shore project. When you look at the entire area of Lake Pontchartrain and Lake Maurepas, any impact that would occur from that project is effectively immeasurable. And also, and I hate to jump into the weeds a little bit, but you do have to think about wind and storm surge. So if you're going to have wind and storm surge pushing over to the west, that really isn't going to affect. It's going to cause you to stack up against the levee, not come back and fight the wind up against Manchac. So what I've advocated, one, yes, we need to get West Shore project completed. If that project had been done, you wouldn't have had the flooding in St. Charles, St. John, and portions of St. James parishes that we had from this storm. But secondly, I think one of the greatest investments that can be made in the state of Louisiana is actually doing some type of low-level barrier at the Wrigley's and Chef Pass pass to prevent water from ever even coming into or stacking up in Lake Pontchartrain and Lake Maurepas. We saw the impacts of even a weaker storm, a Category 1 storm in 2012, Hurricane Isaac, that caused devastating consequences simply because it moved so slowly and was able to load the lake up with water. A low-level barrier, I think, would prevent those types of damages, and it benefits all lake communities, and I think we need to revisit that project and figure out how to get that one in the ground. Look, know what, we shouldn't be saving Peter to flood Paul. That's not the right solution, and I wouldn't support it.